As you know, I have done work on the Bronze Age and prehistory, but today I decided to focus almost exclusively on contemporary matters, on the phenomena we are experiencing today. I'm not going to try and do the work that Jan suggested we should do, to try and link it with the past in kind of, you know, analogical way, because I think it's still too early to instrumentalize this experience. I think it's still too early to actually try and see the archaeological benefits for us before we understand both the materiality, the sensoriality, but also the political effect and the political import of the phenomena we're examining today. So, Jan referred to the special issue that is going to come out in a month or so, or hopefully less than a month, as part of the Journal of Contemporary Archaeology. And I'm just mentioning it because I've learned a lot from my colleagues who contributed to this issue from a wide variety of perspectives. So I'm going to bring in some of that knowledge together today, as well as a report on a project I started this year, but last year rather, on the island of Lesbos. And I'm going to continue this summer with hopefully more extensive fieldwork. Finally, I'm going to summarize some of the insights I gained from my own students this semester, Brown, the first time that I'm actually teaching a course with the same title, a migration crisis, but with question mark. So, despite the ocean of images on the so-called refugee crisis, nothing prepares you for the sheer force of materiality, its powerful and multisensorial affective impact when in the midst of things. It was in April 2016 that I first visited the migrant facility or hotspot of Moria in Lesbos, the northeastern Aegean island on the border between Greece and Turkey, only 4 nautical miles from the Turkish coast, and my main context for this paper today. An old and notorious military barracks, now used for the detention and processing of all migrants who attempt to cross from Turkey into the European Union via Lesbos and Greece. Around 500,000 people crossed through Lesbos in 2015 and up to March 2016, where an agreement between EU and Turkey reduced significantly that number. Now the numbers are much smaller, only about 100 or so per week. And you can see here on this map the various hotspots, so-called hotspots that were set up on the islands, Lesbos, Chios, Samos, Kos, to process these migrants on the islands. So the migrants are not even allowed to cross into mainland. They have to be contained within these islands and be processed and claim asylum or be deported immediately from Lesbos or Kos or Samos back to Turkey. And in fact, there have been several deportations since March 2016. Moria is one of several hotspots that were built along the Greek-Turkish border, mostly funded by the European Union. Materialized and militarized borders are spectacles of security and sovereignty, and as ways of regulating migrant flows, diverting them through other, often more dangerous routes. In the USA, this dogma is called prevention through deterrence. It is a dogma that can also be found in the European Union, African, and Asian borders. The militarization of the border enclaves of Ceuta and Melilla in Morocco, or the border wall built in Thrace between Greece and Turkey, serve the same purpose. They force more border crosses to the sea with the well-known consequences. And I just want to present some data briefly from International Migration Organization to show you the effect of that policy of prevention through deterrence, or we close the border or make your life much more difficult or divert you through other ways with the well-known consequences. These are some of the data on fatalities in the Mediterranean in 2014-16. This is, in fact, not the whole year, and you'll see in a minute the complete data for 2016. And this is the whole world. As you can see, the vast majority of deaths at sea and missing migrants are today in the Mediterranean. Yeah? So this is 2016. The data from 2015 are here, and you can see the increase in numbers. And these are the data this year, from January to the 8th of March of this month. As you can see, the numbers keep increasing. So a direct and material effect of this agreement is the increase of fatalities in the sea. It's the diversion of people into the most dangerous, especially the central, so-called central Mediterranean crossing from Tunisia and Libya into Italy. The liquid border between Greece and Turkey, in effect, the eastern liquid border of the European Union was materialized, militarized, and securitized through these detention centers, but also through the Frontex ships that patrolled the narrow sea passage. These islands were, of course, militarized already due to this strained relationship between Greece and Turkey. But in this new phase, we see the materialization and militarization not of a national border, but of a supranational one. The border of the European Union, not with Turkey, but with the rest of the world's poor and the rest of the world's migrants. This meeting between national militarization and supranational one finds its material expression in this camp, the Camp of Moria, and its detention technologies of the camp. The rusty barbed wire of old, the technology of the 20th century barracks and conscription centers, and on the top of it, the razor wire, the technology of the 21st century migrant detention centers the world over. In fact, on the day of my first visit, a workman was doing just that. He was replacing the barbed wire with razor wire. He was just applying a new layer of razor wire to the top of the old barbed wire and tangling them together. So he was not replacing the old; he was just entangling the razor wire to the barbed wire. So brand rusty barbed wire, shiny new razor wire. Entangled materialities, but also entangled temporalities here. One of many examples of the entangled temporalities of migration to be seen on this island. Another example, memorials of earlier migrations, and this is the sign to the Synikismos, which is the settlement where the migrants from Asia Minor settled at the beginning of the 10th century. Memorials of earlier migrations, migration from the opposite coast to the island during the first two decades of the 20th century, and during the Asia Minor War, as focal points for mourning the victims of contemporary migration and for stages rituals of compassion. Yet, as the anthropologist René has showed, that earlier migration to the island, to Lesbos, is not remembered as a hugely traumatic episode of uprooting, since many migrants came from the opposite coast. And in any case, they had extensive links with the island before the event. Moreover, their movement happened within the same broader landscape with which we were experientially familiar. They did embrace, however, especially in more recent years, the national narrative of catastrophe and the usual ways of commemoration, of its commemoration. In September 2015, it was in this memorial, the memorial of a woman from Asia Minor, located very close to several recent official and unofficial migrant camps, that Orthodox clergy, together with Muslim migrants, prayed together. This was a rare event, considering the ultra-conservative Greek church. Migration reshapes the natural and the cultural landscape, not only of the destination countries, but also of the countries encountered en route. This work on Moria fence to return to the camp was also part of the preparations of a high-profile visit, and that was the visit of the Pope. The Pope was going to arrive in a few days, in April 2016, and he was going to host a meal with 300 selected 300 inmates out of about 3,000 people detained at the time. The anti-border graffiti that I saw in the facade had been whitewashed. Once again, this camp and the island as a whole would act as a world stage. In the broader performance centered around the border crossing spectacle and the rituals of humanitarianism, witness the hundreds of celebrity photographers and the many thousands of images that came out of Lesbos in the past 2 years. As we walked up the hill towards the back of the camp, the remnants of a solidarity camp this time, the Better Days for Moria, were to be seen. Before the EU-Turkey agreement of March 2016, this was a functional open site operated by volunteers and providing vital services. After that date, as all incoming migrants had to be detained in the closed militarized facility, this open camp became redundant. The 10 platforms and footpaths were still clearly visible, but this transient materiality of migration was undergoing fast and accelerated ruination. A member of my group decided to collect a painted wooden panel for her private collection, one of many such private collections that are currently being formed. People collect things all the time, not official agencies, not museums, just individuals. But it was the people behind the fence opposite who wanted to talk to us, asking, and as I was talking about the conditions inside, a group of children detainees who were playing football on a hard cement surface noticed our cameras and asked for a photo. Later that day, the same request was made silently by a group of detained young men of South Asian origin who were staging a hunger strike. The very presence of a person with a camera would prompt them to stand and pose for a photo. To evoke the theoretician, the photographer, and my colleague at Brown, Ariela Azulay, this is the civil contract of photography. Migrants, children, and adults perfectly understand the visual economy of the border and the dynamics of border detention as spectacle. They give the permission, or the illicit photography, they give permission to be photographed, and they demand of us the dissemination of these images and of the message of resilience and courage. This dialectic of visibility and invisibility is at the center of public anxiety and of the various responses towards migrants. This camp, the Camp of Moria, is only 8 kilometers outside the main town of the island, Mytilene, and away from the tourist attractions. When visiting another open camp, Karatepe Camp, established by the municipality of Lesbos, close to the town, the olfactory experience, the smell, will remind you that this is located next to a sewage treatment plant and an industrial and largely polluted area. So this is the sign to the treatment plant you can see next to the camp. Another solidarity facility set up by the anarchist group No Borders Kitchen at the foothill of the medieval castle of the town and its most important tourist site was violently and forcefully dismantled by the police. Later that summer, the same group re-established a solidarity base at another disused military facility very close to the Karatepe camp. They were evicted after only a few days. Since then, they continue setting up temporary facilities only to be dismantled and so they move elsewhere. Within the established humanitarian logic of governmental and NGO organizations, the camp is a necessity that fulfills many functions simultaneously. Homogenization of diverse people as migrants or refugees, enforcement and performance of containment and easy control, surveillance and monitoring of migrants. But at the same time, it also enacts at highly visible objects. The camp is visible. It makes undocumented migration visually prominent, which is essential in gaining financial support. But such visibility can become problematic in contexts where anti-migrant and xenophobic feelings run high. Hence that dialectic between visibility and invisibility of migration. Now, I refer to the No Border Kitchen, which is part of the Uruguay network of called No Borders. The name is of essence here, the name Kitchen, both in their initial base below the castle and their continuous action since. The main focus of the solidarity initiatives have been food and eating. The preparations of meals for migrants and with migrants and their communal consumption. In fact, even without a permanent base, the group would cook and distribute meals from the back of the vans. Shopping for food and cooking here are collaborative efforts involving migrants themselves. It thus takes into account specific cultural norms and sensitivities to do with eating and cooking. The sensorial politics of cooking and of eating are central in the debate around migration, including the debates in the local communities, and the associated practices. Following the dismantling of the initial No Borders Kitchen camp, unsubstantiated rumors had started circulating on the island in Lesbos, that the mostly South Asian migrants who lived in the camp used to kill and eat dogs, stray dogs, that abound in the area. You can understand the, you know, the associations here, and you can actually encounter a trope well known from many others in the context worldwide. The alien as someone to engage in disgusting practices. In a similar example, in one of the most successful and interesting experiments in migrant solidarity, the Pikpa camp, which houses mostly vulnerable groups and people, collective cooking and eating is at the center of the operation. Growing vegetables and shopping for food, cooking and then eating are done collectively by both migrants and solidarians. To recall, the Italian theoretician Esposito here, this is affirmative biopolitics. The sensorial biopolitical constitution of community, community, as opposed to the immunity of the racial, xenophobic, or even of the sanitized humanitarian discourse. By contrast to what's happening here or in the No Borders Kitchen, the provision of foods in the detention centers as well as in the other official centers such as Karatepe, are contracted out to catering companies and are often distributed in uniform plastic containers by volunteers. Migrants who have spent many months in these camps often complain about the very poor quality of food, tired of rice and pasta, for which they often have to wait for many hours in queue. Some of them have chosen to take initiative and have constructed their own fireplace inside or around the camps to cook their own food. Indeed, the detainment conditions at the Moria camp, including food conditions, have led to a number of protests and revolts in recent months. During these revolts, the camp was set alight at least twice in the last few months. Interestingly, these revolts started when the world media had turned their back to Lesbos, when the whole kind of Syrian exodus stopped being such a big news, when celebrities had stopped coming, but conditions nevertheless had deteriorated. Now, setting the camp alight was not only an act of protest, but also a way to produce a spectacle, to assert migrant visibility, to take the initiative in the spectacular economy of border crossing and migration. I went back to Moria at the end of July 2016. The traces of these fires and revolts were still there, yet the detainees were less interested on the visitors with cameras. The police turned down my application to get in, as was, but it was clear to me that different things had changed since April. The overcrowding was at its worst, but migrants had won the right to be able to go to the town after a period of about a month in detention. Weekly demonstrations were held in the town and continue since. The facade of the camp maintained the same appearance of security and militarization as before, and new signs advertising the EU funding had gone up. But if you were to go at the back of the camp, you could have noticed several holes in the fence, openings that would have allowed some of the Danes at least to escape. So we're seeing here the front regions and the back regions. The spectacle of secure border had to be maintained and propagated. But these are already the future ruins of the European Union. My more recent visit was a few weeks ago in January 2017. Things on the island had changed again. This was also the first time I was able to enter the Moria camp. Don't ask how. Despite my repeated attempts to do so officially in the past, the requests, as I said, were routinely ignored. This was in the midst of the heaviest winter in the island for decades, and prior to my visit, Moria and the island as a whole was again in the news, as photos and videos, mostly supplied by migrants themselves, found their way in mainstream media. They depicted a snow-covered camp, collapsed tents, and scattered migrant belongings in the mud. Following public outcry, the government sent a warship to provide temporary shelter, but very few migrants agreed to move in, fearing that they would be deported. The long queue of parked cars outside the hotspot of Moria, much longer than before, cars belonging to the personnel and the members of the various NGOs, spoke of the huge inflation of the illegality humanitarian industry. Inside the overcrowded facility, it became clear that this was a materiality of a palimpsest. From the Greek conscript barracks to the closed detention center in the early and mid-2000s, to the open registration center until March 2016, and now to the militarized closed facility. Buildings, space arrangements, and signage could be dated to a specific period of use. But this was also a labyrinthoid construction, with several layers of metal fence and laser wire, corridors and paths. The main official organization and units, the Asylum Service, the first reception center for registration, and the so-called pre-departure center, which is basically a closed detained facility or a prison, were surrounded by a mass of shelters of different kinds, from prefab houses, porta cabins, and to simple tents that were never meant to withstand winter conditions. The forest of razor wire looked superfluous in this highly militarized facility operated by the police and the army. And yet, the role of razor wire was indispensable, both for the people inside and for the people outside, including national and international publics. The undesirable and detained, the undesirable are detained securely. At the same time, as has been already noted, the razor wire hotspot enacts migration de facto and a priori as criminal. Before you even get to be interviewed, you are seen and you're presented as criminals. It has the term crime migration. As for the asylum center, it was brand new now, after having been burned down at least twice by migrants, and the mass of people pushing paper against its very high metal fence outside perhaps explains why not more people would not escape these horrific conditions of the camp. Aside from the fact that they had already formed communities inside this facility, often based on ethnic affinity or broader geographical origin. My friend Alier from Sierra Leone told me that all Africans are brothers in this jungle. They want to continue living next to the asylum buildings so that they can keep pushing their claim for refugee status. They want to be there because that's where the asylum center is. Nevertheless, it became again clear to me that many migrants have escaped Moria, and other official centers, in fact, and very, you know, they organize facilities, and they live clandestinely on the island, in squads, in many facilities, in many squads organized by no borders, but also in ruined buildings, even in archaeological sites. And they're looking for opportunities to continue their journey clandestinely to the mainland and beyond. Yet, even in these dramatic conditions, which I encountered in January and Maria, even inside one of the most militarized migrant facilities in Europe, placemaking practices by migrants themselves were everywhere to be seen. From creating 10 neighborhoods based on broad ethnic and geographical origin, for example, you show me that this is where the Africans are, this is where the Africans are, this is where the Syrians are, to decorating their tents with small objects and with paint, to tapping into national grid for electricity, to constructing huts outside the tents and cook inside a tin container, to selling cigarettes and other small commodities at the side of the main paths inside the camps, to using specially allocated areas and tents as places for worship, as mosques and other places of worship. How does it feel to be a problem? Asked the African-American theoretician and activist W.E.B. Du Bois in 1903 in relation to the so-called Negro problem in the U.S. The phrase is apposite and powerful even today, especially today, when migrants, both in Europe and the U.S., are racialized again following the show 2015 interval of widespread compassion and state charity. How does it feel to be a crisis? How does it feel to be a bearer of problems, we can ask in relation to contemporary migration? And my question is there a migration crisis? Some scholars and commentators already suggested that what we are in fact dealing with, what we are seeing here, is not a migration crisis, but a crisis of reception on the part of the nation states of the global north. We can even extend this argument and say that if there is a crisis here, it is a crisis of the nation state. It's a crisis of the nation state that struggles to come to terms with the inevitability of global migration and the movement of the working people from global south who have taken seriously our pronouncements on globalization and on time-space compression. It's easy to tell that we live in a globalized world. A movement in both senses of the word. A movement of people who make the colonial past present and immediate, who cannot accept the global allocation of roles attributed to them by capital and its elites. It's a crisis which attempts to enact a delusion of nation-state purity, strict delineation and demarcation, and sovereignty. It is also a crisis emanating from the fact that the global north refuses to take responsibility for its history, both the history of colonialism and the more recent history of neocolonial military invasions, especially in the Middle East, as you know. It is this refusal which has rendered the migrant a problem, a homogenized entity that must be subjected to processes of governmentality and humanitarianism. It is a crisis, however, which has been turned into opportunity. Never let a crisis lay to waste. A crisis which has been generated the illegality and the humanitarian industries. And it is a huge industry, as we know. I hope that it has become clear that in contemporary migration, and I suspect in all migration, materiality, including its sensorial properties and temporality, are of paramount importance. Migration is primarily about the experience of movement through spaces and landscapes, and is thus a kinesthetic phenomenon. But such movement is also a temporal phenomenon. Movement, as well, always involves time. But a phenomenon, a temporal phenomenon, which also cites and recalls other temporalities, and at the same time also cites and recalls other materialities, as it generates and produces new ones. Contemporary archaeology is thus in a unique position to investigate this phenomenon. But an archaeology of contemporary forced and documented migration cannot and should not be like any other conventional archaeology. For a start, as Jan has started doing in the introduction, we should problematize the notion of forced and undocumented migration by exploring and foregrounding the agency of migrants and by showing how the term undocumented emanates from the optic of the state. Furthermore, within the same logic, migrants can easily pass from the state of undocumented to the state of overdocumented, once the various border and immigration agencies subject the migrant body into a whole series of registration, surveillance, and detention procedures. It is also not so much an archaeology of displacement, which assumes that rather passive migrants who is forced to leave his or her place of origin or residence, but rather an archaeology of active emplacement, an archaeology of placemaking practices, of domesticating space, imbuing roots, landscapes, and seascapes with meaning. It is an archaeology that does not focus only on border crossing and its material correlates and remnants, but on the whole migrant experience, including the new material and temporal realities produced in the destination countries, even the material realities produced back in the home countries, analyzing, for example, the buildings and other projects carried out by migrant remittances, the money that people send back to home countries, constructing a whole new world. This is an archaeology of care, archaeology as witnessing, archaeology as activism, and foregrounds critical solidarity. Naturally, our emphasis is on diverse materialities and temporalities, and the entanglement amongst them. It is an archaeological ethnography. Bear in mind, at the same time, that our contribution is more valuable when attending to the microhistories of the material, to the sensorial and temporal affinities of objects, things, spaces, and landscapes, which tell their own stories, often ignored by many other specialists and scholars. Moreover, increasingly migrants are tired of recounting their stories, or having to come up again with a narrative of pain and tragedy, narratives to be reproduced and commodified within the global media and also within our own academic networks. Or such stories cannot be expressed orally due to their difficult nature or because of language barriers. An emphasis on the material, thus, on biographical objects, including artwork produced by migrants themselves, can provide the most appropriate conduit through which we can produce this shared space of dialogue with migrants, defines archaeological ethnography. In the introduction to the special issue that I referred to earlier, I'm suggesting that archaeology of undocumented migration can operate at different levels. A, at the level of the sensorial material, by both studying up and studying down. That is, by directing sensorial attention to the securitization of human mobility and the militarization of border controls, turning thus the cameras towards the surveillance apparatus, but also by directing sensorial attention to the material remnants of the border crossing and migrant experience, including the vast proliferating digital traces. And the internet is another field where these traces can be actually recorded, studied, and analyzed. B, the level of the epistemic level, by helping us understand contemporary migrant experience through the study of natural anthropogenic materiality, by helping us rethink archaeological categories through that experience, how this phenomenon can help us rethink our own conceptual apparatus. C, the level of affectivity, the affective level, by foregrounding the material traces and things that will enable us to be touched, to be affectively moved and empowered by the desire of migrants to become authors of their own destiny. And D, archival, the archival level, by producing counter-archive. There is the archive of the state, the archive of border control authorities. This could be a counter-archive, a partial and situated record of contemporary and documented migration, and by preserving and curating some of the remnants as material and affective agents of an important social process and of this specific moment. Valorizing the remnants of border crossing, these are life vests that have been turned into bags in of the solidarity camps, Pipa, Lesbos. Valorizing the remnants of border crossing and of migratory landscapes, which are often treated as pollution. We often hear that the beaches are polluted because of all these things that are being left behind, is important. Making sure at the same time that we avoid the ruined last or even refugee porn we have seen all over the mainstream media recently. But how do we avoid replicating the surveillance and the recording techniques of states and border apparatuses? And how about the migrants who let us stay invisible and erase the material traces of their crossing or their overall journey, avoiding the detention of state apparatuses, who'd rather bear their past, both literally and metaphorically, bear their fingerprints to avoid detection, for example, as happened at Calais, where migrants refused to be fingerprinted and rather bear their fingertips, or even decide to destroy themselves the material worlds of their journey, as opposed to let them be destroyed by the police authorities and the state. And this is in Calais in October 2016, just before the complete evacuation of the camp, when migrants themselves set the jungle alight. They destroyed by fire all these camps they actually themselves had set up. Following the social lives of these remnants and their unstable and transient materiality, reactivating their sensorial and affective power is important. But is it not time also to study the whole sensorial assemblage of migration? That we direct sensorial attention to the materiality of detention, to the border spectacle itself, and to what Anderson, social anthropology, has called the illegality industry, rather than becoming part of that industry ourselves. Finally, how can we foreground migrant experience as a global social movement of people who have taken their lives on their hands, or better, on their feet? Roughly 2 months after my July visit to Lesbos on the 19th of September 2016, A major uprising broke out in Moria. That day, a 21-year-old Ethiopian woman from the Oromo tribe, who was detained there in Moria, let's call her Adina, happened to be away from the camp as she was ill and she was at hospital. When she returned, she discovered that all her things, including her papers, were burned. But there was something else that she was more upset about. This is her narrative on the blog. My shoes burned in Moria. Before my shoes burned, I used to run. You know, I used to run when I was at school. I was number one in my school. Even when I left everything behind, I kept the running shoes with me. Then that day I got sick. I went to hospital from Moria, so I did not wear the sport shoes. I left them in Moria and Moria burned. I cried about my shoes. I told my friend who stayed in Moria that day, why didn't you rescue my shoes? Why didn't you save my shoes? According to news reports, the uprising that led to the fire started when someone shouted, "Freedom." Thank you very much.